Hello and welcome to another video from the only channel that you need to not only survive the current apocalypse but actually enjoy it. And today's video is going to be about the law, in particular God's law and the direct links that exist between God's law and every system of law ever devised by man from the very beginning all the way up into our day. Even though I think that most of my subscribers are aware of the fact that religion is not in and of itself pleasing to God, most still want to learn as much as they can about the religion of the Jews. A large part of the Jewish faith has to do with law, and in fact, many refer to some of the ancient books upon which the Jewish religion is based as Torah, which translates into our English word, law. Over the centuries, around the world, a variety of cultures have incorporated aspects of the Jewish faith into their own faiths, while at the same time incorporating much of the Jewish law code into their own law codes as well. Our English word culture is closely related to the word cult. When one group of people behave differently from another group, we call the things that define them cultural differences. When someone is involved in a religion, they will often call those who practice a different form of religion a cult, which is short for culture. It is understandable that many people would want to learn as much as they can about the law and religion practiced by the ancient nation of Israel. Passages in the Bible pertaining to both contain a whole lot of detailed information that was obviously recorded for our benefit. Many have concluded that the Bible is God's word. That being the case, many people have to wonder if in fact the law and religion practiced by the Jews is the law and religion that God expects everyone to practice. As a result, many people attempt to adhere as much as possible to the law of Moses as recorded in the Bible. That law, although obviously religious in nature, was in actuality the legal system of that ancient nation, having more in common with the U.S. Constitution than with any church canon law. It would not be wrong to say that the law of Moses was both legal and religious in nature. Unlike those who believe that the law given to the ancient nation of Israel is God's law, some would argue that the law of Moses is nothing more than a plagiarized version of other much older laws practiced long before the Bible was ever written. Their reasoning is that the Bible does not contain the oldest writings of man. Judaism is not the oldest religion of man. The Jewish law code is not the oldest legal system of man, and that many aspects of those things, as recorded in the Bible, evolved from much older writings, cultures, legal systems, and religions. To someone with an open mind and no religious agenda, the connection is undeniable. So if we're going to put our faith in the words of the Bible, we are going to have to come up with some kind of way of explaining why so much of the Bible seems to have been modeled after other ancient cultures. Hopefully, the things that I will be discussing today will help dispel any doubts that someone may have about whether or not the Bible really is the Word of God. Many of the keys to understanding difficult passages in the Bible are hidden in other passages, including those associated with the legal system of the ancient nation of Israel. In other words, understanding the ancient law code of the Jews often turns out to be essential for figuring out seemingly unrelated passages found in other parts of the Bible. That is one reason why the Jewish law code was so carefully recorded and preserved. Many who have deep respect for the Bible will carefully consider every word in order that they might learn as much as possible about what makes God happy and what makes God angry. Whenever such a person comes across a verse that sounds out of line with how they live their lives, they will often take positive steps towards bringing their lives more into alignment with the things that they read in the Bible. One of my subscribers recently sent me a question relating to that law. I need to know if rabbits are a true clean animal. I have heard a lot of different opinions, but don't really know which opinion is scripturally accurate. Yes, I can read the Bible and I know what it says, but when I am reading it, I catch myself second-guessing what it means. I don't mean to be second-guessing the Bible, but second-guessing how those people living at that time understood these verses and how that understanding relates to our current understanding. This is not the first question I have ever gotten from a subscriber that is like this. In fact, this probably is one of the most common forms of question that I regularly receive. If you read everything recorded in the Bible in regard to dietary law, it may sound very concise, very detailed. That being the case, there should be no question as to what foods were clean and what foods were unclean. But as detailed as those instructions were, it must be admitted that they are also very confusing. God seemingly wrote them in such a way as to make them subject to interpretation. It is this basic fact that we are going to be using today to uncover a very basic Bible teaching that seemingly no so-called Bible-based religion is aware of. If they are, they certainly aren't saying anything about it. As our subscriber's question indicates, the ancient people who practiced that law code must have had a better understanding of how to interpret the wording of that code than the average person today. To us, verses such as Leviticus chapter 11 and verse 3 can sound extremely confusing. Whatsoever parteth the hoof and cheweth the cud among the beast, that shall ye eat. This verse, as well as others like it, very obviously do not sound like any kind of conversation that two modern-day English speakers would engage in. The fact that I have been asked more than once about which animals are clean and which are not is a pretty good indication that at least some people can't figure it out. I actually suspect that a whole lot of people can't figure it out. Much of that confusion may be due to translation, but in the ancient past, as originally recorded in the ancient language of Moses, it would probably still be very confusing to the average person. As an example, the passage that I just read, as accurately translated into modern English as I can figure, would sound more like this. That which parts the parts and splits the splits and sends up the small particles among the beast, you may eat. As you can see, even when this passage is closely examined, it is still extremely confusing. But along with verses like this, the Bible oftentimes includes lists of which animals qualify as clean and which do not. And if we compare the list of animals to the technical descriptions of those animals, a pattern starts to emerge which seemingly fits in with these verses being about a category of animals known as ruminants, animals which process their food in an organ similar to a stomach, which first ferments their food, then somehow gets the food back in their mouths where it can be chewed a second time before sending it back to the stomach again for final digestion. Even though rabbits seem to do this, they don't do it the same way that cows do it. Since non-believers are always looking for ways to ridicule God, this seeming discrepancy gets discussed quite a bit. In this video, I won't be taking a stand either way because I don't see the point. There are plenty of articles available on the internet about the digestive tracts of cows and rabbits. Anyone that is concerned about this issue should read what the experts say and make their own decisions. As for myself, I just figure that the one that created stomachs knows more about how they work than me. Ezra chapter 7 and verse 6 describes Ezra as a man from Babylon well-versed in the law given to Moses by the Lord. At Acts chapter 22 and verse 3, Paul the apostle, who described himself as a Pharisee, stated that he was trained in the law. Verses such as these can be found throughout the Bible and make it clear that the law was obviously just as confusing to the common people who were ruled by it as it is for us today. Otherwise, there would have been no distinction made between the common people and those who were trained to understand the law. Several verses in the Bible speak of others who were Pharisees accusing Jesus of breaking the law, but even they must have been unsure. At Matthew chapter 15 and verse 1, Jesus was approached by the Pharisees who brought along with them what are described as teachers of the law. Since the Pharisees, who like Paul, would have been trained in the law, bringing along this second group that the Bible specifically describes as being teachers of the law would be a good indication that there were multiple schools of thought about just how to interpret the law. When Yahweh rescued the nation of Israel from Egyptian bondage, one of the first things that he did after freeing them from the legalism of Egypt was to give them a written version of the instinctive law that he had put into mankind in the beginning. Throughout the world, that written version of natural law has come to be known as the Ten Commandments. The Bible makes a very powerful point of highlighting just how important this law was by recording that God gave the two stone tablets to Moses, complete with the Ten Commandments carved into them with his own finger, the very finger of God. Moses had absolutely nothing to do with the cutting out or shaping of the stones or the carving of the words into the stones. I have heard and read information from more than one source that the founding fathers of the nation where I reside used the Ten Commandments as the basis for the law code of the United States. Since that law code is very similar to the law codes of most other nations, I imagine that the U.S. is not unique in making such a claim. If we think about these claims, even on the most shallow level, then we should have no problem figuring out that there is no possible way that such claims could be true. First, if the founders of any nation had actually wanted to base their law codes on the Ten Commandments, then it would have been easy enough to simply transfer those commandments onto a separate piece of paper, have all of the top officials of the land sign it, and call it the national law. No human ruler has ever done such a thing. Far from being based on the Ten Commandments, the laws of the nation, at best, could never be anything more than a system of loopholes to the Ten Commandments. Second, if in fact the founders of a nation were to declare that their law was based on the law of God, they would also by default be declaring that they were capable of improving on God's law, in effect declaring themselves to be superior to God. When Satan told Eve that she could know good and bad just like God, he was prophetically telling her that mankind could disregard God's law and create its own functional law code every bit as relevant, and in fact, if done properly, better than God's law. Third, all natural law, in particular as recorded in the original Hebrew of the Ten Commandments, would by default not allow for any version of any unnatural hierarchical social order. The command to honor your father and mother was much more than a suggestion to do nice things for your parents. As recorded in its original language, this commandment to honor parents was a law from God describing the only social order approved by God that would allow any human to outrank another human. Parents were commanded to rule over their children. Children were commanded to be obedient to their parents. Such a commandment to honor one's parents by default would be a strict prohibition against giving such honor to anyone else, in particular civilization's political, economic, and religious leaders. Giving such honor to some hierarchical government or governmental official, which as commanded by God should only be given to one's parents, would be a very serious breach in God's law. We have become so used to hearing this commandment in its traditional English form that we simply never think about how to apply it. But if we closely examine how this passage was recorded in ancient Hebrew, we can see how no civilization could ever allow its citizens to follow God's law. In modern English, Exodus chapter 20 and verse 12 would be more accurately translated like this: subject yourself to the governmental authority of your mother and father so that your days on the land that your God Yahweh has given to you will be lengthened. Anyone subjecting themselves to the governmental authority of any entity other than their parents would be breaking God's law. The simple fact that civilization exists is proof positive that the vast majority of mankind, if given the opportunity to be ruled by God and His Ten Commandments, would reject both. For many of us living today, having spent a lifetime suffering the consequences of Eve's rebellion, the prospect of one day returning to living under God's natural law has become our only source of comfort. I spend much of my quiet time trying to imagine what that will be like. I think that many who are reading or listening to this information often find themselves doing the same thing. But as wonderful as that prospect may seem, it must be understood that before we can take hold of paradise, we're going to have to emotionally detach ourselves from everything that is not paradise. The nation of Israel, as a whole, was not willing to do so. After receiving the law from God, Moses descended Mount Sinai in order to deliver that law to the nation. But even before he got all the way down, Moses was able to see and hear that Israel had made for themselves an idol of a golden calf in order to worship it. The Israelites did not have to tell Moses that they refused to live by natural law. Their conduct spoke louder than mere words ever could. When Moses saw the people bowing down to serve an artificial animal, Moses was instantly able to discern that his people were not ready for the paradise that awaited them in the promised land. The worship of artificial animals is not instinctive. Whether someone is familiar with this particular account or not, most would willingly admit that worshiping material objects is not in any way a natural act. Even if someone was a dedicated worshiper of artificial animals, they would likely be willing to acknowledge the fact that they were not born with a natural desire to do so. Such unnatural behavior would have to be learned. Recognizing that the people were unwilling to live by his law, God compromised and allowed Moses to give them a law similar to the one that they were accustomed to. In the short, volatile history of the ancient nation of Israel, God willingly compromised many times in order to allow his people to choose for themselves what they believed was the best way to live. As part of that compromise, God also allowed them to fully experience the negative effects of the choices that they made. The law code that Moses gave to the nation was very similar to the law code that they had lived under while in the land of Egypt. At Ezekiel chapter 20 and verses 24 and 25, the Bible refers to this list of hundreds of seemingly arbitrary rules as the wicked law. I promise you that although this set of laws by which no man could live may have seemed arbitrary, they were anything but. Religious people argue that the law given to Moses was far superior to the laws practiced by the surrounding nations. There is no denying that there were differences, and it would also have to be admitted that those differences would have made the nation of Israel stand out from those surrounding nations. The law practiced within the borders of the promised land would likely have been superior to those practiced outside of that land. But to people with no religious agenda, it should be obvious that the differences between Israel's laws and the laws practiced by the peoples of the surrounding nations would have been very minor, especially when compared to natural law. Many would argue that the law of Moses was no better at all and perhaps even inferior. This new list of rules, this two-way covenant agreement between God and man, just like all of the legal systems practiced by all other nations, including Egypt, was doomed to failure, not because God actively interfered with their attempts at self-rule, but simply because, contrary to popular belief, humans are not as smart as they think. God knew that the humans that he created could only live in the world that he created if those humans would do what they were designed to do, and the world that he created did what it was designed to do. God was also fully aware that his people had to figure this out for themselves. The account of the golden calf is preserved in the ancient writings of the religions of Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. I am not aware of anyone involved in any of those faiths worshiping golden calves today, but am fully aware of the fact that an incredible variety of other foolish activities are currently being practiced by all three. It is obvious that to this day, the basic lesson has as of yet not been learned. Just as Adam and Eve may have thought that they could improve on God's law, the citizens of the ancient nation of Israel may have held out hope that they could improve on God's law as well. Perhaps they could simply tweak the well-established law of the Egyptians just enough that it could somehow be made to work in a way that would be beneficial for everyone. Even in our day, many struggle to make the world around them a better place. It is obvious to everyone that something about the way things currently work is not quite right. But most are not willing to admit to themselves that as society currently functions, absolutely nothing is right. Most refuse to even think about ridding the world of civilization altogether. That being the case, a great deal of effort is still being put into tweaking the latest list of civilization's nonsensical rules. In acknowledgement of the fact that unnatural law could never work, God did not write out this second law with his own finger, as he had with the first. In fact, he would not even provide the two stone tablets as he had with the first law, but required that Moses provide his own tablets and carve the words of the replacement law code with his own hand. And even though God's written version of natural law was included as part of the second set of laws, God would not even consent to writing out that part of what we today recognize as the Ten Commandments. When this second law failed, and it would, our Father wanted to ensure that nobody be able to blame him for that failure. If we compare God's law to every other law code ever devised, we will find that God's natural law is unlike any other law that exists in many ways. The first being that it is perfect. Because it is perfect, there is absolutely nothing that can be added to God's law that can improve upon it. No other legal system can make that claim. In fact, there is no man-made construct referred to as law anywhere as it currently exists that is unaltered from its original state. When laws are altered, we often call those alterations amendments. Most amendments are at least publicly presented as a way of closing up what are called loopholes. Loopholes are shortcomings in the legal code that end up being exploited in such a way as to circumvent the intent of the law. Anyone willing to honestly investigate the actual motivation behind most amendments added to the legal codes of the nations would discover that more often than not, such amendments rarely close up loopholes, but instead seem to create more loopholes. If, as stated earlier, the founders of this nation or the founders of any other nation actually base their legal codes on natural law as claimed, then at best those laws of those nations could never be anything more than amendments to natural law. In effect, loopholes to God's law, loopholes created by man. Any amendments to those laws would in fact be nothing more than loopholes of loopholes. Every law written after a national code is established, whether they are considered amendments, federal laws, state laws, or local ordinance, would by their very nature qualify as loopholes. It is quite reasonable to say that at least 100 new laws or loopholes are created and added to the law codes of the nations each and every day. All of those laws are carefully considered, voted on, drawn up, and added as a means of improving upon or addressing shortcomings in the laws that had been created previously, which themselves came about for the same reason. As an example of just how superior God's law is to man's law, commandments like thou shalt not kill could never be improved upon. No one would ever need to have such a law clarified or amended. As written, the command not to kill fully expresses in a very clear way the fact that according to natural law, killing is wrong. Adding things such as it is wrong to kill with a gun, or it is wrong to take someone across state lines to kill them, or it is wrong to kill on the Sabbath would not make thou shalt not kill any more effective, any more just, or any easier to figure out. If all killings were to become illegal, there would be no hope of the Western world ever imposing its will on the Eastern world, and likewise, without killing, there would be no hope of the Eastern world ever imposing its will on the Western world. Without killing, those who dream of lording it over others would be forced to give up on those dreams. That is why all of the world's legal systems include loopholes in their versions of thou shalt not kill. In recent years, as civilization's need for murder has increased and mankind's access to information has increased, many of Satan's cults have begun to teach that the Bible commandment not to kill would be more accurately translated as thou shalt not commit murder, as if somehow the ancient Hebrew word for kill and murder are two different words. But I can assure you that the command not to kill is accurately translated. The Hebrew word ratsach simply means kill. This word is used in verses about putting criminals to death. It is used to describe killing during warfare. It is even used to describe accidental death. The churches, far from being bastions of truth, exist for one reason and one reason only, that being to ease the consciences of those dedicated to doing the will of the God of religion. Satan. Thou shalt not steal. In the original Hebrew, this commandment has much more weight than that given to it by our pitiful English interpretations. Thou shalt not ganab would more accurately be translated as thou shalt not carry away. As originally recorded, this commandment would not only make it a crime to point a gun at someone and take their wallet, but would also make it equally illegal to ship a banana from Ecuador to Canada. This would not only have been a just and reasonable commandment when Adam and Eve occupied the Paradise Garden of Eden, but would also have been perfect for the Israelites as they journeyed to the Promised Land. In both situations, those who were under natural law would have had all of their needs taken care of by the creation and by the Creator. Adam and Eve would have been surrounded by human food year-round. The Israelites were being brought to what the Bible calls a productive land, and during their journey to that land, continually provided with manna. Once again, it should be obvious that if everyone earthwide were to suddenly start living by the commandment not to carry away, civilization would collapse immediately. The next commandment that I'm going to talk about is thou shalt not commit adultery. As recorded in our English Bibles, it may seem that adultery would have nothing to do with natural law or have any effect on civilization one way or the other. But in reality, just as in the case of all of the other commandments, as originally recorded in the ancient language of the Hebrews, if humanity were to suddenly stop committing adultery, civilization would instantly come to an end forever. In fact, had it not been for adultery, civilization would never even have come into existence in the first place. The word that our English translations of the Bible render as adultery is naoph. In our modern Western world, the English word adultery means sex with another person's spouse. Naoph does not. Naoph simply means unnatural sex. Obviously, many nations do have laws against having sex with someone else's husband or wife, but most nations also have legislation well beyond what is normally considered to be adultery in the English language. Many nations have laws regarding the age difference between those engaging in sexual relations, laws against sexual relations between people of the same gender, laws against having sex outside of the state within which two people reside, laws against people having sexual relations in front of a camera, laws against humans having sexual relations with other species, even laws against having sexual relations with yourself. But linguistically, most of such acts would not be covered by our English word, adultery. If we read the entire Bible from beginning to end, adultery is always associated with civilization and is never once associated with normal sexual activity between men and women. Prior to the moment when God gave the Ten Commandments to Moses, thousands of years of human history had been recorded in the Bible, and the only act of adultery recorded, which can be found at Genesis chapter 6 and verse 4, was sex between human beings and fallen angels. The Bible is a very big book covering a very large part of human history involving the lives of many people. Many important life lessons are discussed in great detail. Most of those lessons are repeated throughout the Bible, multiple times in multiple settings. But overall, there really isn't anything significant recorded in the Bible about the sex lives of those involved. According to genealogical records that are found in the Bible, most had multiple sexual partners. But other than sex acts associated with religious rituals, the Bible never condemned any of those involved. Abraham had multiple sex partners. Rahab had multiple sex partners. David had multiple sex partners. And yet all of these people are specifically mentioned by name hundreds of years later in chapter 12 and verse 11 of Hebrews as part of the great cloud of witnesses. Most of the people mentioned lived after Israel received the law. All were fully aware of the prohibition against naaf, which we translate as adultery, and yet none of them were ever accused of adultery, at least not according to the Ten Commandments. None of them were spoken of as adulterers by Paul. And with the possible exception of King David, none of them would have ever thought of themselves as adulterers. Because according to the Ten Commandments, sex outside of marriage and having multiple sexual partners was not a sin. David's own sin of having sex with Bathsheba was compounded by the fact that he took Bathsheba away from the man who loved her and later had that man killed in order to cover up the fact that she was pregnant with his baby. It would be more logical to accuse King David not of adultery, but of killing, stealing, and coveting. At Matthew chapter 12 and verse 39, Jesus called the people that he lived among a wicked and adulterous generation, but there is nothing in the text to suggest that he was addressing any sexual activity on the part of his audience. His accusations were primarily being directed at the religious leaders of the nation. It is more than likely that he was speaking of the adulterous relationship that existed between the Jews and the demons. The only reason that I am pointing out all of this is to highlight just how much civilization depends on adultery as described in the ancient Hebrew text of the Ten Commandments. Without the close, intimate relationship that exists between humans and wicked angels, Satan would never have been able to take rulership of humanity away from God. According to the Bible, civilization is still under the control of Satan. As the Bible says at Genesis chapter 6 and verse 4, half human, half angel hybrids, men known as fellers who were considered to be famous heroes, lived on the earth in Noah's day, and as the Bible says, continued to do so afterwards. To this day, all human rulers are under the control of Satan, be they political rulers, economic rulers, or religious rulers. If we are willing to acknowledge the law of Moses for what it is, a list of amendments or loopholes to God's natural law, then we can start to understand why the dietary restrictions recorded in that law are so confusing. According to the law given to Adam, what we call instinct, God never gave consent to humanity for the consuming of flesh. Genesis chapter 1 and verse 29 describes a proper food for humans as fruit and vegetation. Even in our day, there are people called vegetarians that are instinctively repulsed by the thought of consuming the flesh of animals. When Noah's ark came to rest on dry ground, God gave Noah consent to consume meat with no official restrictions. But when he gave the Israelites the law of Moses, there were restrictions. As I said earlier, keys to understanding other verses in our Bibles have been written into parts of the dietary law of the Jews. Hence, those laws, as recorded, would obviously have been created in such a way as to serve that purpose. But if we examine the process by which those laws came about, it must be understood that those dietary restrictions had to have been created in accordance with some pre-existing desire on the part of the Israelites to incorporate such restrictions. After all, when God gave them the Ten Commandments, the nation of Israel as a whole rejected them. This second set of laws, these amendments to the Ten Commandments, had to be written in such a way as to please those people. Otherwise, the law of Moses would have been rejected just as the Ten Commandments had been rejected earlier. If we look at how mankind writes laws today and compare that to the process that man used in creating laws 500 years ago, we will see that nothing much has ever really changed. And even when we compare that process from culture to culture, some very similar characteristics stand out. All of mankind's attempts at creating sustainable, fair laws fail. They always fail in the same way. Man's laws have always failed, irregardless of when they were created. They always fail, irregardless of where they are created. They always fail, irregardless of who creates them. And they always fail, irregardless of the perceived righteous motives of those who create, enact, and enforce those laws. God's laws enforce themselves. Breaking natural law always results in harm to everyone and everything. When God gave Moses the original two stone tablets, there were no provisions for how those laws were to be enforced because it was understood that those laws would enforce themselves. The laws of the nations, on the other hand, being unnatural, must by necessity include provisions for a system of enforcement. That being the case, the law of Moses, unlike God's law, included instructions for imposing fines, confinement, and even execution for those found breaking that law. There is evidence that natural law was taken into consideration when the founders of the U.S. wrote the Constitution, but there would have to be whether the founders believed in the Ten Commandments or not. Even if the founders had been unaware of the existence of the Ten Commandments, its precepts would by necessity have shared some similarities with civilization's laws. As an example, according to God's law, killing is wrong. Hence, according to civilization's law, killing is usually wrong as well. People instinctively understand that killing is wrong. Incorporating a few righteous laws into the official laws of the nations has the effect of adding an air of legitimacy to what would otherwise be obviously illegitimate. By necessity, the founders of any nation would have to include laws against killing, otherwise they would likely end up getting killed. People in general don't enjoy being oppressed. Fancy clothes and fancy wigs would hardly protect a founding father from a large crowd of his victims. It should be obvious that had there been no restrictions against killing during the recent U.S. election, many would likely have died. The prospect of being ruled by a greedy, unjust man or a greedy, unjust woman caused many citizens of the U.S. to become filled with negative emotions. Had there been no firmly established system of punishment and reward for killers, there is no way of knowing what the consequences would have been. But we can rest assured that those consequences would not have been good. God's law, in its original language, cannot be open to interpretation. The prohibition against killing cannot be interpreted in any way that would allow humans to kill one another. As recorded in the Bible, "Thou shalt not kill" can only be interpreted one way. You shall not make a living being stop being alive. But according to every other law ever created, the prohibition against killing would be open to interpretation, including the law of Moses. Anyone reading the Bible would have to recognize the distinction between the Ten Commandments and the law of Moses. But the churches are always at the ready to explain that somehow both laws are the same law. Atheists who believe that the Bible is a product of man will quickly point out that the Bible contradicts itself. Many of the verses that are used as proof text for this assertion are based on the very obvious contradictions that exist between the Ten Commandments and the law of Moses, which is probably why God refused to have anything to do with the carving of the second set of laws. It could be said that every law code that existed in the ancient past was nothing more than an amendment to natural law. As time progressed and those nations fell, the nations that took their place enacted similar laws, which were usually nothing more than amendments to the laws of the nations that they replaced. Even though there have been several amendments to the U.S. Constitution, it must be admitted that in its original form, the Constitution itself was never anything more than an amendment to the Law Code of England, which itself was nothing more than an amendment to the Law Code of Rome. All of today's legal systems have evolved from earlier legal systems. The oldest written document of any length is the Code of Hammurabi. Written hundreds of years before Moses was even born, this law code shares many similarities with the law of Moses and hence our own modern legal systems. Even though human laws are constantly being amended in mankind's vain attempts to get them to work, God's natural law has never once had to be amended whatsoever, at least not by God. The instinctive law placed in our original parents requiring mankind to do such things as eat human food, rest, and care for the earth is still the only law ever devised with any chance of success. Some of the ten are pretty self-explanatory, even as translated into English. Thou shalt have no other gods before me, in English, for the most part, likely communicates just what it would have communicated to the ancient peoples as originally written. However, if we continue to read the rest of the passage, we will see that this law was about much more than bowing down to golden calves. Thou shalt not make any graven image or any likeness of anything that is in the heaven above or in the earth beneath or that is in the waters beneath the earth. Thou shalt not bow down thyself to them nor serve them, for I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children unto the third and fourth generation of them that hate me, and showing mercy unto thousands of them that love me and keep my commandments. This passage is very obviously a very detailed prohibition against materialism, having nothing at all to do with religion. The words translated as bowing down and serving these material things is not so much about performing rituals as about work in general. Anything that is modeled after any part of creation that requires work to construct, power up, refuel, repair, maintain, and replace would meet the requirements for breaking the commandment to have no other gods before me. Even though there are no words found anywhere in the Bible that could be translated as Satanism, many passages do describe the worship of Satan. It is also obvious to anyone willing to read the Bible with an open mind that all such passages could just as easily be describing consumerism. The concepts of Satanism and consumerism as presented in the Bible are pretty much interchangeable. Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain, for the Lord will not hold him guiltless that taketh his name in vain. For most people, even in English, this verse should be relatively easy to figure out. However, those that are the most guilty of breaking this commandment control the most powerful propaganda system ever established. Most churches publicly deny what this verse is about and have most of mankind believing that taking the Lord's name in vain is about using cuss words combined with the word God. A better English translation of this passage might be, "Do not speak of God in a misleading way." Even though the world's religious leaders are not alone in their slandering of God, it must be admitted that they are taking the lead. Another commandment that may not at first seem to be associated with natural law would be to remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. Many recognize the Sabbath and honor it by not working once every 7 days. But since there is some disagreement as to which day is the Sabbath, those who honor it often do so on different days. In the ancient past, the entire Eastern Hemisphere acknowledged a 7-day cycle in the natural world that no longer exists. At several scriptures, the Bible states that God was changing times and seasons, and from that point in human history, whatever once took place every 7 days came to an end. meaning that until Christ returns, there will be no more Sabbaths. Without some easily recognizable universal celestial phenomenon occurring every 7 days, Sabbath worshipers are pretty much stuck choosing a day at random. In Hebrew, the word Shabbat, which we translate into our English word Sabbath, is closely associated with the word Shabbathon, which translates into our English word rest. But most do not make the connection between our modern word Sabbath and the ancient word Shebeth, which translates into seat. This word appears 4 times in the Bible. It is used to describe Solomon's throne. It is also used to describe a seat of authority occupied by one of David's 3 mighty men. It is also used to describe the Shebeth of evil and violence. It is also used to describe the location where those who willingly practice religion are to be hemmed in by iron rods and burned alive at the final battle of Armageddon. All of these occurrences of the word Shebeth are direct references to celestial phenomena which no longer occur in the natural world. Planets taking positions between the earth and the sun. In the ancient past, as empires rose and fell, celestial phenomena were often associated with those events. No doubt, when Christ returns and all of the wicked angels who have ever ruled over mankind are displaced from the earth, similar celestial phenomena will take place as the means by which God will announce to mankind the beginning of the 1,000-year reign of Christ, God's chosen ruler. As Satan's empire is finally replaced by God's kingdom, mankind will finally be able to rest. The 1,000-year reign of Christ being the millennial Sabbath. From that time onward, mankind will never again be confused as to what day is the Sabbath. Once Christ returns and restores our solar system, every 7th day will once again be marked by a very obvious event in the heavens, which will eliminate any doubt as to which day is the Sabbath. The commandment to not bear false witness against thy neighbor is always presented by the churches as if it is about falsely testifying against someone accused of committing a crime. I have read articles about how even though the Bible condemns all forms of lying, it condemns perjury even more harshly. And that is why the commandment, do not bear false witness against thy neighbor, specifically addresses this form of lying and not just lying in general. After Christ returns, no form of lying would be tolerated, and in fact, it is doubtful that anyone would ever have any reason to lie in the first place. With Satan, the creator of the institution of lying, no longer having access to mankind, there would be no motivation for anyone to lie. This commandment is not about perjury, although this passage would obviously cover such an act. As accurately translated, this verse would sound more like this: you shall not use the spoken word to communicate things that are not true in order to manipulate one another. All lies would fall into this category, but it must be understood that we live in a world where not lying can often cause pain and suffering. Romans chapter 3 and verse 4 encourages us to trust God, even when we don't trust anyone else. The point being that humans lie all of the time. God does not. Each of us has to determine just how much truth we can safely express to the vile liars of this world. There is very little sin in lying to those who are out to do harm to us or those whom we love. This verse is not about lying in order to harm someone's reputation. It is about lying in order to do harm in general. Exodus chapter 20 and verse 17 is a prohibition against desiring what belongs to another. Most of us understand the basic idea that is conveyed by this commandment, although as translated, there might be some confusion as to the exact message. Thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's house. Thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's wife, nor his menservant, nor his maidservant, nor his ox, nor his ass, nor anything that is thy neighbor's. In this passage, it sounds as if this is about coveting a man's property. In English, a house is a structure that people live in. A wife is a woman that is owned by a man. The words translated into menservant and maidservant are often translated in many versions of the Bible as male slave and female slave. Once again, property. And the ox and ass in our day would normally be considered as property as well. What this verse is about is coveting the families of others. The word that we translate as house in the Bible is often translated as family because in some verses translating this word as house would make no sense. After Christ restores the paradise, the concept of owning material things such as houses will no longer exist, and no one will ever again even consider owning humans. Words such as wife and slave are not found in this passage in the original language, and after paradise is restored, such words will no longer even exist as part of the human language whatsoever. To repeat what I said earlier, unlike the laws of the nations which require unnatural systems of enforcements, God's law has always enforced itself. According to Romans chapter 6 and verse 23, the penalty for breaking natural law is and always has been death. The damage done to our planet by those choosing to live by human laws has resulted in a world that is unsurvivable. Until Christ returns and restores our planet, the penalty for all of us will continue to be death. If we keep in mind that God gave the Israelites their law as a compromise between natural law and Egyptian law, then we should be able to easily understand why there would be a question as to which animals were clean and which animals were unclean. Unlike natural law, which would be part of our genetic makeup, unnatural law, like the law of Moses, would require professionals trained in the law in order to interpret it. At creation, Adam and Eve would have understood that the fruit hanging over their heads within arm's length would have been an appropriate source of nourishment. Whether or not to eat a camel or a cow would have never entered their minds. The first line in what we today call the Ten Commandments is this: I am the Lord thy God, which have brought thee out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. The American Empire is nothing more than a modern-day continuation of the Egyptian Empire. The laws of the current regime are very obviously an amended version of the laws of Egypt, and by default, an amended version of God's law. If you have ever been subjected to any part of the current empire's law code, be it tax law, property law, civil law, or criminal law, then you would have instantly recognized the extremely detailed way in which that law is written. You would also have recognized that no one could ever understand that law unless they spent many years being trained to understand it. Much of what we suffer under the man-made law codes is not according to the written law itself, but according to how that law is interpreted. About 2,000 years ago, Jesus came to earth and demonstrated in a very powerful way what life would be like when the time finally came for him to take over rulership of the earth and reestablish natural law, God's natural law, what we today know as the Ten Commandments. Jesus healed the sick, raised the dead, fed the hungry, calmed the weather, and taught the truth. Never once did Jesus break the law of Moses, the local law code enforced by the Judean government, or the national law of Rome, and yet he was executed as a criminal according to all of those law codes. He was tried before the Sanhedrin, then tried before Herod Antipas, then tried before Pontius Pilate. He was not found guilty of any of those laws as written, but as interpreted was found guilty according to all of them. He was hated by the people for being no part of the world. So that which was written according to the law made no difference. In our day, the law works the same way. Anytime that two individuals find themselves at odds in a legal dispute, Neither the judge nor the jury are interested in weighing the evidence. Instead, they weigh out the difference in the individual's participation in the fiction of civilization. Haircuts, clothing, wealth, credit scores, careers, citizenship, club affiliation, military service, church membership, country of origin, race, gender, and voting history play a far greater role than any facts concerning the actual legal dispute. At Matthew chapter 5, verses 17 through 19, the Bible records that Jesus told his followers, "Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. For truly I say to you, until heaven and earth pass away, not an iota, not a dot will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Therefore, whoever relaxes one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven." The varying sects of Christianity argue about whether Jesus was putting an end to the law of Moses or telling people that the law of Moses would never end. As is always the case, none of the religions of civilization have ever taught, nor will they ever teach, a correct version of God's word, the Bible. Such a thing would present a serious conflict of interest. Jesus was not speaking specifically about the law of Moses at all. The word that he used in this passage is the Greek word nomos, which simply means law, as in religious law, economic law, governmental law, or even unwritten law. This passage was simply a reaffirmation of the fact that Christ would rid the world of all laws on the day that he would return and rid the earth of the demons, not before. As the verse says, when all things are accomplished. While on earth, Jesus made a point of declaring all foods to be clean, and after his death, several other Bible writers highlighted this fact. But that does not mean that he was commanding people to eat things that were illegal according to the laws or traditions of those we live among. After Jesus declared all foods clean, there is nothing recorded in the Bible to indicate that his followers began to openly eat things that would offend their neighbors. Someone who lives in a land where eating pork is illegal, whether by written law or unwritten law, should seriously consider whether or not it is logical to ignore such rules as a means of demonstrating your dietary freedom. The same would be true of eating beef in a land where the eating of beef is under similar restrictions. We are quickly approaching the day when Christ will return and remove the demons from the vicinity of the earth. Many alive today will experience the privilege of entering into God's kingdom without ever having to experience death. We are too close to the end of civilization to do something stupid and get ourselves killed. If it is illegal to eat pizza where you live, then don't eat pizza. Those who walk into God's kingdom without ever dying at all will be the greatest in that kingdom. Those who are resurrected will be the least in that kingdom. Obviously, this verse is not about hierarchy as we think of hierarchy under Satan's empire. The greatest in God's kingdom would be parents. Being alive at the beginning to witness the resurrection of the dead would certainly make those of us who survive Armageddon much like parents of those who come afterwards. While it is true that God promises to resurrect the dead, it has to be acknowledged that never dying in the first place would be a much more desirable option. Many religionists claim that the dozens of Bible verses about the end of the Jewish law code were added by the Catholic Church, but thousands of ancient Bible manuscripts still exist in museums around the world, and none exclude the verses in question. There can be no doubt that all such verses as they exist in our English translations of the Bible were there from the very beginning. If those verses had been added at a later date, somebody, somewhere would have by now unearthed some ancient manuscript missing those questioned verses. It's been argued that the Jews continue to practice the law of Moses, but there really isn't any solid evidence to support that argument. In fact, if you are willing to honestly research what actually happened to the Jews, it doesn't take long to figure out that the people of Palestine, who for thousands of years have occupied that land, would for the most part be the descendants of those who survived the genocide of the first century. After all, in the Bible, God himself said that there would never be a time when the family of Rechab would not occupy the promised land. But since those people no longer have governmental control over the land and for the most part practice Islam, there isn't any historic continuity between the laws practiced by the peoples that fled Egypt and the laws practiced by the current residents of that area. In any case, beginning in the end of the 19th century and continuing into our day, the Anglo-American Empire has been actively engaged in incarcerating, assimilating, and exterminating the people that inhabit that land and replacing them with Europeans. The governmental policy by which this is being accomplished is called Zionism. In order to add an air of legitimacy, many of those that were brought into that part of the earth belong to religions loosely based on a form of the religion that was practiced in Jerusalem in the first century. Many others were convinced to convert in exchange for land or money or both. What those people refer to as Torah is only practiced as part of their system of religious rituals and is not in any way enforced by the state. When Moses wrote his law, it was not just a list of rules about how to perform rituals. The law of Moses was the law. Very soon, the Antichrist will ascend to power and restore Jerusalem to its former glory. It is very possible and even likely that he will reinstitute his law code, not as part of a system of religious rituals, but as the actual law enforced through violence by a paid armed force with very severe consequences for any individuals not in compliance. It is also quite likely that this law will not be just for those living in the Promised Land, but for everyone earthwide. In the very near future, marijuana laws will likely be replaced by bacon laws. But shortly after this happens, Jesus will return and rescue humanity from Satan's empire, and we who have patiently tolerated civilization's oppressive reign will witness with our own eyes the end of mankind's system of unnatural rules forever. When mankind first entered into its covenant with Satan, each and every one of the Ten Commandments was broken. The very first thing to happen involved covetousness on the part of Satan. He coveted Adam's family as a fallen angel. Satan was not even of the same species as Adam, much less the same family. Satan used deception in order to do harm, bearing false witness against his neighbor. And the lies that he told Eve were very obviously lies about God, very much like the lies told by the churches in our day, taking the Lord's name in vain. The deception that he used led to the death of each and every one of us, breaking the commandment not to kill. He set himself up to be worshipped as a god in opposition to the true God. In order to do this, he stole humanity away from God. He and humanity engaged in adultery with one another as part of the deal. A governmental hierarchy was set up in opposition to God's hierarchy of the family. Upon entering into the Satanic Covenant, mankind began to engage in work, breaking God's law to remember to keep the Sabbath holy. And the work that mankind engaged in was driven by consumerism, the making of idols, the act of using our living planet as a source of material for the manufacture of material things. Once God's kingdom is restored, the trees of life will be restored, and never again will human beings have to struggle to figure out what is good to eat and what is not good to eat. We will instinctively know that the fruit hanging over our heads at arm's length is appropriate for human consumption according to natural law. From that time on, no human being will ever again even think about consuming the flesh of any of the other beings that willingly share this planet with us. No one will ever again have to struggle to figure out whether or not it is okay to eat a rabbit. Once civilization is done away with forever, God's Ten Commandments will no longer need to exist in written form. When on earth, Jesus was once asked, which is the greatest of the commandments? At Matthew chapter 22 and verses 37 through 39, Jesus responded by saying, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul and all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. The religious leaders who are asking the question would have immediately recognized that Jesus was not quoting one of the Ten Commandments. Once humanity is restored and love once again becomes a natural part of life for everyone, there will no longer be any reason to enumerate a list of rules about the difference between right and wrong. With the exception of natural law, all law will be done away with forever. If you don't want to survive, don't listen to me.